Welcome to Triratna Day 2024. Really good to have everybody here. I'm here on Monmouth Street in central London, and my name is Jnanadhara. I'm going to be your host for the day. So this day, Triratna Day, is a collaboration between myself, international movement coordinator at Dharma Chakra, which is the team behind the Buddhist Center Online, Future Dharma Fund, who we'll hear from soon, and lots and lots and lots of other people. So there'll be people celebrating Triratna Day all over our Buddhist community, all over the world, and many of them are with us now. So welcome to you all. I can't see you all right now, but I can feel you. And just to say as well, we've got simultaneous translation happening for Spanish speakers, and at some parts of the day we'll also have Hindi translation for people in India. So yeah, so like I said, I'm standing on Monmouth Street in central London, just in front of 14 Monmouth Street, which is the premises that was the first home of the Triratna Buddhist community, or the FWBO as it was. And Monmouth Street is right in the center of London. It really does feel like central London here. We're very, very close to the West End Theatre District, and so many iconic London places are right by where we are. So Piccadilly Circus is just down the road, for example. And this area was laid out in the 17th century, and it's called the Seven Dials. So there's seven streets that radiate out from a central point, which is just down there. And in the right in the middle, there's a sundial, which was put up, oops, Daisy, we've had a little camera mishap, in the 1690s or something like that. And apparently this district has gone through a whole lot of different phases. So for at one time, in the time of Charles Dickens, it was a notorious slum, apparently. These days, it's kind of trendy coffee shops, quite upmarket shops. So the shop that's in 14 Monmouth Street now is a quite shishy perfume shop. A bottle of perfume in there costs you £135. Anyway, that's just to give you a bit of a sense of where we are. So of course, yeah, the movement was started by Sangharakshita, and we're going to hear the story of that in just a moment with Mahamati and Nagabodhi. And the actual the shop was a kind of a curio shop that sold things from the Far East. Again, we'll hear about that soon. And that the Buddhist Center was actually in the basement. And on this day, on the 6th of April 1967, Bhante, as we call him, Sangharakshita, started this new Buddhist movement with a dedication ceremony, which they conducted in the shrine room. And he wrote some special verses for that occasion, which we now know as the dedication ceremony. So many of you will be familiar with these verses. We often recite them at the beginning of retreats or big order gatherings, or people often recite them for their weekly team meetings. And I really love these verses. They say so much about the way Sangharakshita communicated the Dharma. And they say so much about the way we practice it. So they're both very practical and down to earth, but they've also got a real sense of poetry and symbol and image. So it's a little bit, sometimes I feel like these verses are like Triratna essentialized. And one of the verses in that dedication ceremony says, "Around this mandala, this sacred spot, may the flames that transmute samsara into nirvana arise." So what was initiated on that day, you could say, is a kind of mandala of transformation. And what this day is called, this Triratna Day, is Origins of Transformation. So what we're going to be doing over the course of the day, and I'll say a little bit more about what the different events will be in a moment, is we're going to be seeing how that spiritual transformation was set in motion, how that's continuing today, and we'll also get a glimpse of how that might continue into the future. So yeah, so the Triratna Buddhist community, or the FWBO as it was, started from this particular spot and the planet, and it all started here. This is the, in a way, the center of the mandala, the sacred spot, as we say. And on the face of it, it's a very ordinary shop, and it's, I can't tell you how small it is. I was thinking it's smaller than my living room, and my living room's pretty small. So I don't know how small the basement is, but I imagine it's as small, if not smaller. Incidentally, I asked, could we have a look in the basement and maybe do a little film? But they, all their top secret product development goes on in the basement. So I was told by the manager of the shop, there's absolutely no way that anyone's going to be able to go into the basement. So yeah, it's special what happened here. And one of the other verses is, not by the chanting of the sacred scriptures, not by the sprinkling of holy water, but by our own efforts towards enlightenment, we dedicate this place. So it's very much about individual commitment to spiritual growth. That was what's initiated, and doing that with other people. And of course, this is the essence of our Buddhist community, is people developing and growing in the Dharma, and doing that with other people and inviting other people to join in. So it's wonderful just to stand here on the street. I've been here a few times over the last few days, just kind of imagining the time, in 1967, just to give you a little bit of, just to sort of help you locate yourself in that time. 1967 was the year that Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band came out, the Beatles' famous, iconic LP. Came out just a month after the Triratna Buddhist community was started. And incidentally, Brian Epstein, who was the then manager of the Beatles, his office was just a few doors down the road on that side of the street. Anyway, like, we'll hear more about that time soon. I just want to give you a little bit of a sense of what's going to be happening over the course of the day. So for some of you, some of these events will be happening over the course of the day. For those people in Australia and New Zealand, some of these events will be happening in the middle of the night. For people in the Americas, they'll all still be in bed. So hopefully you'll be able to come. Well, you will be able to come to one or two, or maybe even three or four, or maybe five or six of the six events that we have. So the first event we'll hear is happening in just a moment. I'll say more about that in a sec. The second event will happen in a few hours' time, and that's going to be an international Metta Bhavana, which will be happening live from the London Buddha Center. We will have people rejoicing and friends from around the world. The third session of the day is called a Mandala of Transformation. So that's looking at what happens around the London Buddha Center in Bethnal Green, not too far from here. People living and working together in communities and businesses. And I'll be talking to those people and trying to get a sense of why they do that and what that means. And then in the fourth session, we're going to be going to India and hearing a talk from Naga Ketu. And he's going to be talking about generosity, the practice of generosity and the transformation of society. And then in the fifth session, we're going to be hearing from Windhorse Publications, who this year are celebrating 50 years of publishing Dharma books. So we're going to be talking to Dharma Mega and her team and some of the Windhorse authors and editors. And the last session of the day will be a celebration of the of Dharma Chakra, who have been distributing particularly Sangharakshita's lectures and Dharma talks from all sorts of people all over for the last, well, since the movement started. And they're also the team behind the Buddhist Center Online and Free Buddhist Audio. So that's the sixth session. So all the details of these things are on the website, and you can click on there to join any session you want. And also during the session, we'll be inviting members of Future Dharma Fund to talk to us about what they're doing and their work, and they'll be inviting us to contribute to their fundraising efforts. So in a moment I'll stop, but what I thought we could do is we could start our day in the way that the movement was started, by reciting the verses of dedication. So what we've got is we've got some people at the Glasgow Buddhist Centre who will be doing the response to those verses. So I'll say a line, and then if you want to at home, you can say it with me, and together we'll dedicate our online Triratna Day festival, starting it the way that our movement started 57 years ago in this very place. So we're ready to go? We can hear the Glasgow Buddhist Centre?
Hello.
Yeah, fantastic. Okay. The dedication ceremony. We dedicate this place to the three jewels.
We dedicate this place to the three jewels.
To the Buddha.
To the Buddha.
The ideal of enlightenment to which we aspire.
The ideal of enlightenment to which we aspire.
To the Dharma.
To the Dharma.
The path of the teaching which we follow.
The path of the teaching which we follow.
To the Sangha.
To the Sangha.
The spiritual fellowship with one another which we enjoy.
The spiritual fellowship with one another which we enjoy.
Here may no idle word be spoken.
Here may no idle word be spoken.
Here may no unquiet thought disturb our minds.
Here may no unquiet thought disturb our minds.
To the observance of the five precepts.
To the observance of the five precepts.
We dedicate this place.
We dedicate this place.
To the practice of meditation.
To the practice of meditation.
We dedicate this place.
We dedicate this place.
To the development of wisdom.
To the development of wisdom.
We dedicate this place.
We dedicate this place.
To the attainment of enlightenment.
To the attainment of enlightenment.
We dedicate this place.
We dedicate this place.
Though in the world outside there is strife.
Though in the world outside there is strife.
Here may there be peace.
Here may there be peace.
Though in the world outside there is hate.
Though in the world outside there is hate.
Here may there be love.
Here may there be love.
Though in the world outside there is grief.
Though in the world outside there is grief.
Here may there be joy.
Here may there be joy.
Not by the chanting of the sacred scriptures.
Not by the chanting of the sacred scriptures.
Not by the sprinkling of holy water.
Not by the sprinkling of holy water.
But by our own efforts towards enlightenment.
But by our own efforts towards enlightenment.
We dedicate this place.
We dedicate this place.
Around this mandala.
Around this mandala.
This sacred spot.
This sacred spot.
May the lotus petals of purity open.
May the lotus petals of purity open.
Around this mandala.
Around this mandala.
This sacred spot.
This sacred spot.
May the Vajra wall of determination extend.
May the Vajra wall of determination extend.
Around this mandala.
Around this mandala.
This sacred spot.
This sacred spot.
May the flames that transmute samsara into nirvana arise.
May the flames that transmute samsara into nirvana arise.
Here seated.
Here seated.
Here practicing.
Here practicing.
May our mind become Buddha.
May our mind become Buddha.
May our thoughts become Dharma.
May our thoughts become Dharma.
May our communication with one another be Sangha.
May our communication with one another be Sangha.
For the happiness of all beings.
For the happiness of all beings.
for the benefit of all beings.
For the benefit of all beings.
With body, speech, and mind.
With body, speech, and mind.
We dedicate this place.
We dedicate this place.
So, thank you for helping dedicate this Triratna Day. So now I'm going to hand over to Mahamati and Nagabodhi, who are at Urgyen House in Addis Dana, where Bhante spent his last days. And they're going to be speaking to us about Treasures in the Foundations exhibition, which looks at the period from 1965 until 1970. So the years just before and just after that day in 1967 when the movement was founded. So yeah, so I'm really looking forward to interacting with you and seeing you over the course of the day. And without further ado, I'll hand over to Mahamati and Nagabodhi, and I'll see you at the end of this session. Okay, ta-ta for now.
Thanks, Jnanadhara. It's just amazing, Jnanadhara, to see you in Monmouth Street, just outside the Sakura Center, where the Triratna Day, where Triratna was started all these years ago, 57 years ago. It's also rather amazing to be here in Urgyen House with my very old friend, Nagabodhi. And as we, most of us know, this is the place where Sangharakshita, Bhante as we call him, lived the last 5.5 years of his life. And behind me, there are these photos, more than 100 photos of Bhante at it would be the first 60 years of his life. And it's often when people come into this exhibition, this is the place that they first go to look, because it's seeing so many transformations of Bhante from a little boy right up until he was 60. So we are here to introduce you to the exhibition that we have called the Foundations Exhibition. And it was a great idea of Jnanadhara's that we should do this, because this is the foundations of Triratna, and this exhibition is starting in 1964, going up to 1970. It's an exhibition which you can view in person, but also you can view online. And in some ways, you get an even better look if you go online, because quite a lot of the exhibition are the original letters and documents and so on that chart what happened in those extraordinary years when Bhante first came back to England initially just for a few months, ended up staying for 2 years, and then after a return farewell visit to India, came back in 1967 and established Triratna. So without further ado, I shall hand over to Nagabodhi.
And I'm hoping that also I'll be handing over to a slideshow, which our Parajita is magically going to put on the screen. Fantastic. There are various foundations that you could talk about in relation to Triratna. There is Bhante's experience with the Diamond Sutra when he was 16, his writing of the article, The Unity of Buddhism, when he was 18, his ordination in India, the writing of the survey and the writing of the Eternal Legacy, where he unfolded his global organic vision of the total Buddhist tradition. And then there was the invitation from the English Sangha Trust to visit England. Now, the picture that you're looking at is not that invitation. That must have been lost, and it's maybe upstairs in some archives. But meanwhile, what we have is this rather fascinating letter to Sangharakshita from Christmas Humphreys, following up the invitation from the English Sangha Trust. He's sort of telling Sangharakshita that, okay, come, because the Buddhist world in England is in chaos. There's complete breakdown of diplomatic relations between the Buddhist Society and the English Sangha Trust, which were the two main Buddhist institutions in the UK at the time. The English Sangha Trust, which was inhabited by bhikkhus, or was meant to be, seemed to be teaching some very strange meditations and flirting with the occult, and put it to Sangharakshita that he should come and establish a proper Theravada Vihara with monks, with bhikkhus and shramaneras, trainee monks, and just do the right job which the Vihara was designed for. Now, then, you know, there's a picture that follows on showing Sangharakshita and Christmas Humphreys in earnest conversation. I don't know where that was. My hunch is that that would have been on one of Christmas Humphreys' visits to Kalimpong. But I'm kind of surprised that Christmas Humphreys expected this of Sangharakshita. He must have known by then that Sangharakshita was no ordinary monk, no ordinary Theravada monk. But anyway, it's worth reading the letter, not least to see how much Christmas Humphreys thought he was going to be managing Sangharakshita and telling him what to do for the rest of his life. But of course, the rest is history. I'll hand back to Mahamati to take us on to the next picture.
Yeah, and so now we're going to see Bhante's diary from January the 1st, 1965. And unless you've got a big screen, you may not be able to read it, but you can certainly, when you go online, you can go close up and you can read it. And if you come here, you can see the actual diary that Bhante kept. And it starts, after 20 years in the East, I find myself at the beginning of 1965 in England, where I have now spent a little more than 4.5 months. Not unexpectedly, this has been a busy period, though an interesting one, and I feel, so far as the Buddhist movement in this country is concerned, a time of crucial importance. So how true that turned out to be. And in this diary, Bhante goes on to speak about how he has found, as Nagabodhi's just given a hint, the whole British Buddhist community split. And he describes, I'm quoting, questionable meditation techniques, brackets, to date, 3 persons driven insane, including one who is permanently confined to an institution, to say nothing of scores mentally injured, alienated, and antagonized. So it was a pretty terrible situation in certain respects, certainly as regards the way meditation was being taught. And for Bhante also, he recounts a little later in another document we have, in March 1967, again quoting, after my arrival in England in 1964, I received something like a shock. The Buddhist movement in England was far smaller and more insignificant than I had been led to believe, and both intellectually and spiritually quite mediocre. So he doesn't mince his words. So anyway, so now Bhante starts his work lecturing at the Hampstead Buddhist Vihara and the Buddhist Society, various local groups, Leeds, Brighton, Manchester, Oxford, Cambridge, and as this newspaper cutting indicates, he visits Norwich. Actually, he gives a talk at the Assembly House, which those who know Norwich will be familiar with. And he also visits Hastings on the South Coast, today, one of the places where Triratna's Southeast Buddhist group regularly meets. I don't know whether anybody's there from Hastings. And in his diary of 9th of January, Bhante writes, at Hastings, took the meditation class from 3:45 to 5:30. Nice atmosphere, with most people practicing earnestly. Mrs. Smith, a bit argumentative afterwards, said that as for metta, she was practicing it all the time anyway. So anyway, as well as giving talks, Bhante led retreats, often at Hazelmere, a property belonging to the English Sangha Trust. And finally, just for this section, going back to that diary, we won't see it again, but January the 1st diary, Bhante writes, during 1965, may I progress towards supreme enlightenment, and with the blessings of all the Buddhas, Bodhisattvas, Dharmapalas, and Dakinis, may the Dharma continue to spread in England.
And keeping on that photograph of Sangharakshita there, I mean, it's sort of noticeable that he's got a bit more than a usual bhikkhu's crop. You know, his hair is beginning to grow. Now he's in his robes and he's probably giving a lecture. And for, you know, he was working very conscientiously for the Hampstead Buddhist Vihara, as Mahamati has just explained. But he was kind of already beginning to see himself and his project differently. He'd been wrestling with issues, the issue of orthodoxy, of what it means to be a monk, for that matter, what it means to be a Buddhist, pretty much since his ordination. He was questioning issues about the tradition, about the need to follow any one particular path, and his life, going from being ordained into a Theravada Nikaya to living among Tibetans, writing a book about the whole Buddhist tradition and all the literature of the Buddhist world. And he clearly was thinking far, far more broadly. And now in England, he started to experiment. Like growing his hair was the least of it, but in particular through his friendship with Terry de la Mer, a photographer, a professional photographer in the advertising world. He, you know, through their friendship and their connection, he kind of let Terry introduce him to being a Londoner. So as well as traveling around in London and getting to know London, you know, under Terry's supervision, Dennis, as Terry called Sangharakshita, went to a shop and bought a set of civilian clothes. They might sit in a pub watching people. It was a very, very strong friendship. And it's kind of interesting that there's a letter again in the collection, in the little booklet, in which Terry writes to Sangharakshita saying, "I worry that I'm taking advantage of your kindness," because he was valuing the friendship and the sort of, this introduction to Buddhism and deeper thinking in various ways that Sangharakshita could offer. But for Sangharakshita, he felt that the playing field was very level because Terry was introducing him to what it meant to be living in the West. He took to staying over in Terry's flat more and more often because life in the Vihara, which had got better under his supervision, but was still for him a stiflingly Theravadin world, also a very busy place. He much preferred to spend time over with Terry, where the two of them would talk often late into the night. But for Sangharakshita, it was a time of internal ferment as, you know, what it was he was doing. Was his life going to be going back to India, to working in London at the Vihara, or could it be something else? And Mahamati will take us to the next step.
Well, one of the things that was something else was that Bhante conceived the idea to go on a pilgrimage to the ancient and Renaissance sites of Southern Europe. And in June 1966, Bhante and Terry set off in the little bus. We got a picture of the little bus. This is what Terry called the Volkswagen camper van, which he'd originally, when Bhante had met Terry, that's when Terry had given Bhante a lift back from the first lecture that Terry had heard Bhante giving. And they went on this journey through Belgium and France to Italy to visit these sites. And since childhood, Bhante had been strongly drawn to the ancient world when he'd read about the ancient world in the children's encyclopedia. And now he's visiting these places for the first time. And for him, it wasn't just a holiday. It was a pilgrimage, as I mentioned. And writing of this time, of his time in Florence, Bhante writes in his memoirs, "The places we visited and the paintings we saw had meaning for me. Through them, I was reconnecting with my cultural roots, reclaiming my cultural heritage. For although I was a Buddhist, I was a Western Buddhist. And now I had the opportunity I wanted to immerse myself in Western culture." So they arrived in Greece, and here Bhante is at the Parthenon. And after arriving in Greece, Bhante writes, "It was exciting to be in Greece at last, exciting that a dream had come true." So it was a dream come true. On returning to London, he writes, and again, this is from our exhibition, the magazine or small journal, The Buddhist, in October 1966, that he's now decided he's going to return to India for a farewell visit, and he's going to base himself in London. And in this article, I can't remember whether we got a close-up of it. Yes, we have. "Moreover, as the months went by, attendance at meetings and classes steadily increased." So he's talking about the 2 years almost that he's already been in London. "And I found it difficult to abandon those who, they said, were still dependent on me for guidance. In this way, 6 months became a year, and a year more than 2 years. After thinking the matter over, I have recently come to the conclusion that the progress made during this period is sufficient to justify my shifting." Oh, I don't know exactly what it says after that, because we'd have to open up the exhibition case and I haven't got the keys. But presumably it says shifting my base from India to London.
So the idea was to go back to India for a farewell tour, returning to England to start work. And the first thing that he wanted to do was to catch up with old friends, to talk to them, meet them. And here's Dada Rinpoche. I love that picture of the two of them together, to talk about his plans and to receive the blessings of his teachers. So I've noticed in some sort of messages flowing around in the movement in recent years, people wondering, did he ever receive the blessings of his teachers? And he definitely deliberately went to India to get that blessing. That was him with Mr. Chen. This is him with Kachyu Rinpoche. He also met up with the Dalai Lama for quite a long conversation, as well as with Lama Govinda and various others of his teachers. It's worth mentioning that when I met Dada Rinpoche in 1982, he told me that Tibetan Buddhism, in his view, was of no use to people in the West. He said, it's taken us 1,000 years to integrate the Dharma with Tibetan culture. This is what you've got to do in the West. This is what Sangharakshita is going to try and do for you in the West. And then he laughed and he said, do you know, if I was a younger man, I would have loved to go with him and do that. But he had his own business to do in Kalimpong. But I think it demonstrates the extent to which Dada Rinpoche and his other Sangharakshita's other teachers, they realized, they knew what Sangharakshita was taking on, not just to go and represent one of their traditions, but to take on this process of bringing the whole of the Dharma and somehow integrating it with Western culture. Quite a project.
Yeah, but in his decision to base himself in London and not in India, Bhante had been concerned not to abandon his many friends among the newly converted Buddhists in India. So in these months in India, Bhante toured widely and attended many meetings, giving many lectures, communicating that although he would be returning to England, he would not forget the new Buddhists in India, and that he would continue to help in any way he could. And the first program was in Bombay. In fact, the day after he arrived in Bombay, he started a series of 11 programs. It means 11 lectures in different places, in tenements, on open spaces, in halls. And we saw just now a Marathi advertisement for a program at the Japanese Buddhist Vihara, Buddha Vihara in Worli. And in Ahmedabad, he gave 11 lectures. In Pune, many more lectures. And I was just looking at his memoirs yesterday. And in Pune also, he did a baby naming ceremony for no less than 20 children at one time. And no doubt many other things he did. And the final program was in Nagpur on the 23rd of October. And we've got a newspaper cutting in this connection. It was a one-hour talk on the 10th anniversary of the mass conversion, which had taken place in October 1956. So this was just 10 years later. And this was when Dr. Babasaheb Ambedkar and his wife had converted, and followed by Dr. Ambedkar leading the conversion for 400,000 to 500,000 followers. And as Bhante had written at the top of this newspaper cutting, according to newspaper reports, 200,000 to 300,000 people were present at this meeting.
So the journey continued in India and arrived finally in Kalimpong, Sangharakshita wanting to visit his Vihara and see how that was going, how the land was going, and the orchards he planted were going. But what was waiting for him was this letter from the English Sangha Trust, from a Mr. Galston. And it was telling him that effectively and in terms, as well as not acting like a proper bhikkhu with his frequent absences from the Vihara, from the sort of things he was teaching, because as well as teaching Theravada Buddhism, he was giving talks on Zen, on Tibetan Buddhism, trialing his approach to the higher evolution and so on. But also there was this slur regarding his friendship with Terry de la Mer, and it was very, very much just innuendo, talking about his extramural activities. You know, altogether this added up to a reason why they had to ask Sangharakshita to recognize that they could no longer support him, that he would no longer be welcome at the Vihara. And the best thing he could do would be to write a letter saying that he'd realized that his future lay in India. When Sangharakshita read this letter, his first response was to say to Terry, who was with him, "Do you realize what this means? This means a new movement." He did write to Mr. Galston, and I think there's an extract, you know, from his letter, just saying, you know, my main concern, oh yes, well, we might as well have it all. I do not propose to deal with the spurious accusations through the medium of correspondence. My main concern is to safeguard the Buddhist activities in Hampstead, you know, and to look after the people who were very much looking forward to his return. But he had already realized that this turn of events, unfair, unreasonable though it might have been, gave him the moral freedom to start his own movement. And so in correspondence with people like Emil Boyne, who was the owner of the shop that would eventually become you know, our first center, and lots of friends, he learned that there was uproar back in London. The Hampstead Theravada world was having meeting after meeting where the governing board were being again and again voted down by the members, but remained absolutely stalwart in their decision to have nothing to do with Sangharakshita. So it was up to Sangharakshita's friends when he returned to welcome him, to give him somewhere to live, and to support him while they got on with the serious business of starting a new movement.
Yeah, and actually what we see now on the screen is Bhante's letter to Emil. Emil was the owner of the Sakura shop where Jnanadhara introduced the day from, and was actually one of the first 12 order members, along with his wife. So once Bhante had seen that a new movement was required, and he was going to be the one to start it, he set about thinking how to set it up. And he was in correspondence with a lot of friends in London. And in this handwritten letter from Bhante, he comments that the idea of forming a committee, I can't remember whether we have a close-up of this one. Yes, no, that's something else.
Oh, the names.
It is, isn't it?
Yeah.
The idea of forming a committee is a good one, though I do not like the name Friends of Sangharakshita. So it means that Emil and his friends had suggested, let's call this movement Friends of Sangharakshita. So Bhante writes, I do not like this name. Friends of the English Sangha would be better. And what actually happened was, by the time of the establishment of the movement, which we're celebrating today, the 57th anniversary, friends of the English Sangha had become friends of the Western Sangha. And then a year later, with the first ordinations, the name became Friends of the Western Buddhist Order. So as well as thinking about the name, Bhante was thinking about fundraising. It's all very familiar to us, I'm sure. And in this notebook, actually, it's at the top, it says Dana Appeal. It's a draft Dana appeal on one of Bhante's notebooks. And in this draft Dana appeal, we don't know exactly what finally was printed, Bhante has written, calling on those motivated to give the financial support so pressingly needed if our movement is to get underway with proper urgency. And further on, he writes, inspiring leadership and hard work can take us a long way, but we obviously need money. So familiar, isn't it? For the initial outlay is particularly heavy. If you are willing and able to help us financially, a donation, particularly a donation, would be, again, we'd have to turn over the page, but probably it says, would be much appreciated.
But the money, or some money, was raised. People were keen, and Emil Boyne came up trumps with the offer of the basement of his shop in Monmouth Street. And so the shop was called Sakura. And as you can see on the little banner they had outside, you know, it had underneath Zendo, which must have been Emil's personal favorite. But it was in that basement that the first center, the first presence of the English, the Friends of the Western Sangha, took place. Maybe we can see a picture of that basement now. I think it's there. There you go. That's Sangha actually being interviewed by BBC Radio London down in that basement. Now, Bhante told me several times, and I'm sure my memory is correct, that behind that curtain was a coal hole. And he had to be very careful when he was sitting there leading classes not to lose his mindfulness and fall back into it, something he never did. But you know, it was a dark and slightly dingy place. But in some accounts I've heard of people who were there, the place was vibrant. There was an electric atmosphere. Obviously, Sangharakshita was leading most, if not all, of the classes. You know, maybe there'd be a dozen people there. In one record I've read, there were 24 people crammed in there. Maybe that was for the dedication ceremony of what they called the Triratna Buddhist Center, which is interesting. Now, somebody I met entirely by sort of luck and chance in Cardiff had been along in those days, and her memory was that the place smelt of socks. Now, take your choice, whether it was a place a bit dark and dingy and smelly. Certainly to the people who stayed around, they remember a place that was just humming with something very important, very electric, very, very significant for them and for the future of the Buddhism in the West. So over to you.
It probably smelled of incense.
A lot of, hopefully, yes.
So a year later were the first ordinations, which is on the 7th of April. And actually the ordinations, they certainly didn't take place at Sakura in that basement. They took place at Center House. And here we've got the diary that Bhante wrote, probably same day or the next day, where he describes... he writes, arrived at Center House at 10:15, found nothing ready, cleared and arranged a room, set up shrine, etc. People started coming, including bhikkhus, started at 11:15. So basically, Bhante needed to prepare the room himself for those first ordinations. And then his diary says that at 12, he spoke on the idea of the Western Buddhist Order and the Upasaka ordination. And as far as I know, the audio doesn't survive unless we somehow find the reel-to-reel tape in the archives here at Adistana. Just as Moksha Priya and Paramartha, in preparing the exhibition, found the reel-to-reel tape of the first ordinations last year, which are part of our exhibition and you can hear online. And at 5:30, Bhante gave another talk on the Bodhisattva vow. And at 7 p.m., the ordinations, and we see one of the very few photos we have here of the 9 men and 3 women, those who were ordained. It lasted for about an hour. And possibly this is the very first ordination. I've heard it said the very first ordination was a woman. There were 3 women and 9 men ordained on that day. And the diary simply notes, everything went off very smoothly and successfully, all most pleased. And there are a number of newspaper reports from that day in national and local newspapers, with headings like this one, Roy 43 starts his second life. Others that we have in the exhibition, Sarah joins the British Buddhists, budding Buddhist, somebody doing a play on words there, and local Buddhists receive ordination.
I mean, what followed from these ordinations, you know, was a very, very creative time from 68 till 70, where the exhibition ends. Sangharakshita was meeting regularly with people who came to the centre, giving public talks as well at places like Caxton Hall or in that place, Centre House, which is where I first went along. Talks about the higher evolution of man, as we would say in those days, the higher evolution of the individual, about the White Lotus Sutra, about Zen, about Tibetan Buddhism, as well as Buddhism and art, you know, and themes of that sort. So he was very much really getting to work, if you like, curating the entire Buddhist tradition, choosing which texts to give talks about, which areas of Buddhism to explain and talk about with people, and at the same time introducing his followers in the connections between Buddhism and Western culture. It was a creative time in that The Three Jewels, a book that he'd been writing for some time, was published, I think, in 69 or 70. He was still writing poetry, of course, and writing... I can't remember, probably he was working on, no, I can't remember which book he would have been working on, probably finalizing The Eternal Legacy, but also painting. I don't know if the word's painting or drawing, because this is, you know, is it what's called pastel paint or something, but there's a lovely little series here in the exhibition, and there's one across the room, which unfortunately you can't see, of a rather interesting looking fish about to maybe or maybe not bite a worm. So it was... just a time for him of just continual creativity and activity. And meanwhile, the Sangha was growing. What, in a way, unfortunately wasn't growing in any fast way was the order. And by the time I got involved myself in 1970, very few of those original order members were to be seen. But the people who were in the room when I arrived in November 1970 for a talk on the Jewel in the Lotus was about 30 people. You know, that was Triratna in 1970. But so many of those 30 people are still around today. It's as if there was a sorting out during that period from 68 to 70 of, you know, people more and more realizing what Sangharakshita was about and wanting to be involved.
Yeah, so 1970, Bhante goes to the USA. He spends 3 months at Yale University. It was his first trip. And apart from coming back for 2 weeks of the Easter holiday, when he came back to lead the Easter retreat, he spent 3 months there. And we have in our exhibition a letter from Yale dated 15th of February, 1970. Which we can show on the screen, writing to, we didn't actually have that in our, that's fine. Sorry, Aparajita, who's doing a wonderful job moving the pictures up in Manchester. He's not here with us. In a letter from Yale, writing to his friend Keith, Bhante writes, "It's surprising how many people have heard of me already, or had even met me years ago in either India or England." And he also writes, "Last Sunday, I started a meditation class followed by a discussion. So many people turned up, mostly students," that looks like that's one of the students, "that we could not hold it in the fellows lounge as originally planned. and had to use the college common room instead. What with 60 to 70 people meditating, most of them cross-legged on the floor, with only the candlelight flickering up through the darkness into the huge Gothic arches of the hammer beam roof, it was all most impressive. So we'll just take a pause from our the pictures.
Oh, yeah.
So here we are. We've been in a little box. The whole technology didn't make it possible to show us in a bigger box next to the pictures. We hope that you've enjoyed some of the images, which are just a very small selection from what we have in the exhibition. Mm. I wanted to say that Bhante, in his 1970 a retrospect, which was he wrote in the following year, 1971, and is published in the Complete Works, along with Moving Against the Stream. Bhante made it clear that he went to America partly in order to see whether the movement would survive without him. And when he came back, he recounts that he was now assured, this is in his own words, that he could not only stand, but even walk. So he recounts that he returned with enthusiasm to the accustomed routine of meditation classes, meetings of the order, public lectures, council meetings, seminars, and retreats. So the movement did survive, didn't it?
It did, and it's still here 57 years later. There's a retreat going on outside the room.
Mm.
I think there's two, there's a, I think a Birmingham Centre retreat and a gay men's retreat there going is. On here at Addis Ababa.
I saw on the notice this morning.
And around the movement, all sorts of things are happening. Mm. There are people celebrating their own festivals in their own centres. I'm participating in the Arioloka mm. Celebrations in a few hours by Zoom.
Mm.
And then back to talk with Dhammamaker and others about Windhorse publications. Mm. And so the day will go, and so the movement continues to grow. And you're looking at me as if there's something I've forgotten.
No, but there's something I'm going to say. Something I'm going to say, that I have here a copy of Nagabodhi's book. Was published last year. The Boy, the Monk, the Man. And I'd like to, as well as saying how good it has been to be with all of you this morning, and to wish you a great remainder of Triratna Day, which I shall also look forward to participating in as much as possible, to encourage you to read Nagabodhi's book, and also do go online, if you can come to Addis Dhana, come to Addis Dhana. Look at the exhibition. We've just given you a small introduction. I hope you've enjoyed this introduction and this looking at the foundations of our wonderful movement, this time of the foundation of our wonderful Triratna movement.
Thank you very much. Thanks for watching, and good luck to the rest of you for the rest of the day.
So thanks so much, Nagabodhi and Mahamati. That was a wonderful, just a very full exploration and evocation of that particular time. And hopefully gives a bit more of a sense to those of you at home of what happened in and around this place all those years ago. So thanks so much. Really fantastic. I should say that I'm here with Sangadhara, who's standing behind the camera, and Akasa Jyoti also, who's been doing all kinds of wonderful things behind the scenes, getting with the technical side of things. We've just been sitting across the road at the Monmouth Coffee Company, listening to the session. There we go. That's where we were, just over there. And so thank you again so much. Really wonderful. What we're going to do now is just, we're going to hear a little bit from Pundarika and Future Dharma Fund about their work. And after we hear from Pundarika, I'll just say goodbye, and then that'll be the end of this first session of Triratna Day. So over to you, Pundarika.
Thanks, Jnanadhara. Yeah, thank you. And thank you to everyone for such a rich first session. So, yeah, I'd just like to talk to you a little bit about future Dharma and kind of the theme of the Triratna Day. So as we're reflecting on the genesis of our movement that's born from Sangharakshita's vision from a humble London basement, as we've heard and seen, we're reminded of the transformative power that lies within each of us. In a world besieged by strife, from conflict to climate crisis to economic instability, the imperative for change has never been more pressing. But at the core of this change lies a profound shift in consciousness, a transformation that our movement, Triratna, embodies. Our founder, Sangharakshita, was tireless in promoting this transformation. And we had a real sense of that this morning. Today, we honour his legacy by looking ahead, by nurturing the champions among us who carry forward his vision, striving to spread the gift of the Dharma to all corners of the globe. And indeed, we can see that from the range of, you know, locations that we're all zooming in from today and for the rest of the day. The ripples of transformation emanating from our community are vast and ever expanding. And it's through the generosity of donors to Future Dharma that we can amplify their impact. The Triratna Group in Japan are a great example of these transformative ripples in action. Thanks to the hard work of Aryapala, a small group is flourishing in Tokyo and even has its first mitra, Susanna. Susanna has told us how vital it is to bring teachings like the Metta Bhavana into her country, where so many people experience depression and low moods, which are rooted in a strong sense of materialism. Future Dharma donors make sure that money is not a barrier to the Dharma taking hold in the next place that's hungry for it. We have and will receive a multitude of blessings today from champions all over Triratna. To reflect your gratitude for the day and to enable more people to meet the Dharma wherever they are, will you make a gift of £50? Or 58 euros, or 95 Australian dollars, or 105 New Zealand dollars, or as much as you can give. Today we want to raise £5,000 for Dharma projects all over the world, and if 100 of us give the equivalent of £50, we can do this. There'll be a link shared in the chat that I can see, and for you to make your gift. Thank you so much for your time, and thanks in advance for your generosity. And I do hope you enjoy the rest of Triratna Day, wherever you are.
Thanks so much, Pundarika. Thank you for that. So Future Dharma Fund, we're trying to continue the work of what Sangharakshita started all those years ago. So like I said, that's it for the first session. Feel free in a moment just to unmute yourselves and say hello if you want to. And we'll be back in about an hour and a half, well, exactly an hour and a half, actually. And for session two, when we're going to be practicing meditation together with the London Buddhist Centre's Saturday morning class, which will be led by Manju Siha, and we'll be hearing voices from around the world, including France and Russia and India and Australia and other places too. So, yeah, maybe see you in a little while. Okay, thanks. Bye for now.